fascinating gadgets, gizmos, and gear-based technologies.
Welcome to FGGGbT. This is the show that takes your favorite fictional science and technology, and we make it a reality. We are the Brain Trust. I am the analytical mastermind, Daniel J. Glenn. With me, the physics phenom, Dr. Michael Dennett.
Well, Dan, it is great to be here. It used to be I'd get nervous when you'd mention horror, but you know what? Your taste in horror is so awesome, I'm much more relaxed these days. I'm just going to go with that.
I appreciate it. I like to scare you with some style, I think, is really what I'm trying to do. And I'm definitely doing that this week. And there's one man who knows both scary and style, and that's our enigmatic engineer, Ben Siepser. Ben, how are things going alone there up on the brain station?
You know, it's been very scary here this week, Dan. I've been floating around and it kind of feels like I'm just going in a loop over and over again. Maybe the station even feels a little smaller than I'm used to. I don't know. It's probably nothing. But, you know, maybe I just need to take a break and get a change of scenery.
I think you might need to come back down to earth with us because, here, it's sometimes it feels like every day is just like the last. We've already done our episode on Groundhog Day, gentlemen. but this show definitely has flavors of that. And we're talking about the TV show From, which, you know, as a fan of Lost, this one really captured my attention, guys. You know, basically, this family is on a road trip. They see a tree down in the road right in front of them. They can't go any farther. They go backwards, and then they end up getting caught in this town, in this basically this loop where they can't get out of, you know, this particular location, and monsters come out at night. There's all kinds of weird stuff and, you know, crazy social interactions. It's wild and crazy. And Denon, I know this is not quite up your alley, but I'm curious what you think, because I have a really good feeling I'm able to relate to you in a certain way.
Well, actually, this, you know, is the type of horror I love, except for the blood. But what I find is they do a pretty good job of, at least the parts I've watched, because I have to admit I haven't watched the whole series, of minimizing just what I would call blood to freak you out for blood's sake versus the psychological horror. I find more of a psychological horror, which is close to a psychological thriller. Which is close to a psychological mystery. And those are ones I really like. So, Dan, I think you've hit kind of my sweet spot of horror. If you're going to have blood, the other weird stuff in this movie is exactly what I like.
I also think you've created a new proof, by the way. I mean, Pythagorean would be pretty happy with what you just did there. I like that.
You know, I will say it was when they showed the bodies, though, I think it was very gory for my taste, but but outside of those moments, there's this impending doom in the show that's very interesting, and the mystery of it all is very interesting. You know, hopefully we'll get further seasons so we can finally find out what the heck is going on in this show, because so far, it's a mystery with no answer, which Jade has discovered.
You will find all sorts of answers, I believe. That's what makes this different than Lost, I think. But, you know, I'm going to kind of relate to you guys in a way, in a very nerdy way, in a very, you know, fantastical way. But I think that there's some relevance. What the heck am I talking about here, guys? Now, you guys know I love Dungeons and Dragons. I think we've all kind of talked about that. And one of my favorite campaign settings was this place called Ravenloft. Now, Ravenloft worked as a pocket dimension in the ethereal plane. For those non-nerds out there, that's where the ghosts hang out, right? All the ghosts and baddies. Mm-hmm. So this world kind of had a malevolent sentience that went out into the world and pulled, you know, people and dragged them into this, against their will, dragged them kicking and screaming into this pocket dimension. Mm-hmm. And I think this kind of connects to From in an interesting way, because we kind of see some of those mechanics, right? We see people getting pulled from the real world into what I'm just going to say it's a pocket dimension of some kind. You see kind of an evil overtone. You know, there's a lot of strange happenings. So I know this is fantastical, but then, and I'm curious, is there any kind of connection to what's going on in this show?
Well, I think there really could be, Dan, because I loved Ravenloft also, but we only did one campaign. I DM'd the castle and the vampire. And I don't remember any of the stuff you're talking about. I totally believe you. So I think my memory was wiped by the evil malevolence as I escaped from the pocket dimension. And so that directly connects to From in that way. But, you know, other than the fact that I have no memory, I love what you're talking about here and this idea of thinking about what is drawing the people in and what is the spatial structure of From is really a lot related to this. And Dan, I do have to say, you gave me one of my favorite childhood memories as a DM, where I had the vampire take over the wizard in the party, who then basically like went to town on them. And it was quite exciting. In the end, they did catch and kill the vampire in a very clever way. I will leave that for a later date. A little mystery there.
I love that. That's great. Yeah. Well, you know, and that's Count Strahd von Zarkovic in Castle Ravenloft.
Yes, exactly.
Out there who wanted to test my knowledge. I know what's going on here. But Ben, I know you love Dungeons & Dragons.
I do.
You kind of stay away from the scary stuff. But you know, anything that you saw here?
Well, I mean, absolutely. I mean, if you recall, Dan, when you ran a Dungeons & Dragons game for me and some other folks, it was Ravenloft. And you pulled us.
I do remember that.
Us as ourselves, our characters into Ravenloft, and then we got cool powers, and I became a druid.
That's right,
because I like playing druids. And so, you know, I think I don't know how this relates to From, but if I got stuck in there, I would hope I would get the druid powers, which would maybe help me out in the forest to survive.
What that is, I did not expect you to go there, Ben, but all great information that I
am all over that druid power thing, Dan, because the trees supposedly move and you know, what better character in From than a druid? I think Ben nailed it. We're done. Well, like we can just go home now.
Or you just wild shape into a spider and hide at the top of the tree. And I don't think the monsters can get you there.
These are all great solves. Now, if we lived in the world of Ravenloft, we've got it figured out. But we're living in the world of From. But, you know, you guys mentioned a lot of things here. When you get trapped in a place you don't want to be, what's your natural instinct? It's to get out, right?
Yes.
And that's kind of what we see the characters trying to do in this world, is they're trying to get out of this seemingly, you know, this loop, this whatever, wherever they are, which is what's kind of tricky. And you mentioned trees, guys. Trees play a very interesting role in this show because a tree kind of signifies the beginning of the loop. I don't really know what we're going to call it. If it's a loop, if it's a pocket dimension, if it's some kind of travel, but they see this tree in the middle of the road is really like the gate coming down on them. And now they are the rats stuck in the maze, you know, and they're trying to find the cheese or whatever. So that's where it begins. But there's also trees that let you travel around the world, not out of the world, but within the world, which is kind of interesting. And there's also talk of trees moving, there being some kind of active, you know, the geographical and the flora and fauna, including the trees, just seem to move around in a way where the world seems to be rewriting itself or shifting and moving. So all of this stuff, this is a lot of weird stuff we've got to kind of figure out here.
Yeah.
It definitely is. I'm really, the thing that most interests me in the trees is the gates and how they work, Dan.
Okay.
Because clearly from the outside, you know, we see that map in the sheriff's office, and from the outside, trees can fall anywhere. So the entry points are at least all over the United States, if not international. And it is a weird entry point, right? Because you drive up to a tree and now you're in the world. Like, when did you enter? Like, what point on that road driving did you enter is one of the really interesting questions. Because to your point, you enter somewhere else, and then you hit the doorway that doesn't let you out.
Once you hit the tree, you're no longer free.
Yeah. Great. Great statement.
Right?
Yeah, I mean, I wonder if it's, you know, I think to a different property, I think of Shang-Chi when he's in this, you know, bamboo forest that's like constantly shifting around.
Right.
And I'm just wondering, like, is it just that you end up on this road and it's just long enough that, like, once you get to that tree, the woods have now like shifted behind you. Somehow there was a somehow the road shifted as well. So now you're in the loop and you're stuck. it also makes me wonder, like, if you somehow managed to be out, like, where the, because obviously you can't get to the tree again, because because you can drive in a loop once you're inside. So it's like some sort of like double, one-way valve, basically, into the system.
Okay.
And so I'm curious if you happen to be there when somebody's getting stuck, could you like find the tree again?
Mm-hmm.
And then when the next person gets stuck, could you somehow, you know, walk your way out? Because like, is it an opening valve or is it some sort of other, you know, malevolent system?
Yeah, because that tree represents, in some ways, it either represents the opening or the closing of the access to this world.
Right.
And so I wonder if you could find that tree that's down in the road, if you could step over it and get out. Like, is that, you know, is that, but you'd have to find the hole again. But this makes the whole world, the structure of the world is extraordinarily different and weird, right? I think that, you know, just, I don't think the geography and even the way the entire world is structured seems extraordinarily different than our reality.
Well, it's really a question to me of how the edges of that world are structured to as a starting point. And we've talked before a little about some of these interesting topology things, like when we did Vivarium and the structure of that world, which is interesting. And, you know, we've talked about fun things like Mobius strips, which are two-dimensional but have only one side. And, you know, you got your basic sphere, donut, you know, double hole donut and weird structures. And as you move around,
donut.
Yeah, I don't know. It was hard speaking that word, Dad.
That's all right. I've never heard that before.
And but in this case, it's really like the topology or the boundary effects that matter. Like in physics, we talk a lot about whether boundaries are periodic, which means if you go out the left, you come back on the right. So a lot of early video games. A lot of early video games are periodic. Asteroids.
Got it.
Right.
Mm. You're right.
And then sometimes, you know, the boundary conditions, just everything goes to zero at the boundary. That would not be good for these people if they found the boundary.
Right. I mean, dead.
Yeah, like nothing. Like you hit nothing. Zero. Okay. Like the values of everything become zero. So your value becomes zero. I'm assuming that's dead, Dan. I don't know how that translates.
Right. It's not one. We know that. It's not one. It's just zero.
Now, there are some boundary conditions where it's one at the boundary. Like in physics, these are the things. And we often do things like where it's periodic in one direction, like maybe horizontal, but vertically it goes to zero. And this is what we torture our students with, are these boundary value problems, they're called. And Ben's flashing back because that comes up a lot in antennas. So I know that's problematic here. So this is Ben's personal horror film now. We've just thrown him into that.
They do try to make a radio, so.
Yeah, not to mention the real antennas in the show later on.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So I think boundary conditions are the heart of this, Dan, for me.
Okay.
Yeah. It makes you think, like, you know, it made me think about, like, if you somehow had a long enough rope and you laid it out on the road that, like, loops through the town somehow and never closes, if you kept that rope in place when a newcomer comes in, would you find it, like, sliced after that event? Like, did the ground shift to open up the world? Or is it, like, teleportation or something instead?
That's interesting. Well, so there's this big moment where in the show, one of the guys who's, you know, he and his family have just shown up in the town and they end up in a house with this big, you know, a big in the hallway. It's just a big white wall. And so he uses it as a whiteboard. He starts writing down his notes and figuring things out. And, you know, here's what I saw. Here's what's weird. And he starts trying to figure it out. And this is a great start because just really quickly, I'm curious, you know, let's say the three of us are trapped in a world. What are we doing to try to get out? How are we trying to your point, Denon, how are we trying to figure out the boundary conditions? Is there a way to do that? And Ben, what are the practical ways once we have some of those theories, you know, how could we figure them and experiment and try to get out of this place? Denon, I'm curious with you first.
Well, you know, Ben starts, you know, one idea that you have in topology is if you like make a rope around the road, it's really interesting if you can close it or not. Because if the topology is that you're in a donut, there's a hole in the middle and that rope can't close on itself anymore because it gets stuck at the edge. So that's okay. A useful thing if you could all kind of get on different sides of the rope and walk together and see what happens. That would take a while. You're in the woods. Could be scary.
Right, yeah.
It really is an interesting question. How is the world periodic? Like, is it just if you're driving on the road? Or if you're sitting on the road and you walk perpendicular to it, what happens? Mm-hmm. So a big first question I'd want to answer, I mean, you know how long it takes to drive around the loop. You can find the opposite side, right?
Okay, right.
And to get there and send some sort of signals, maybe have flares or, you know, if you really want to, you can walk through the woods. You really want to know if there is a direct connection between the two opposite sides of the road or is there a hole in the middle? That's your core first starting point. The corollary is if you send a signal away from the inside of the road, does it loop around back to the town also? Because if things are periodic in that direction, weird things can happen. So, and these are the sort of things you want to figure out what happens when you leave the road perpendicularly, because that's going to give you the basic geometry of the boundaries.
Yeah.
Okay. That makes sense.
Yeah. It's really... Yeah, I mean, I like the flare gun, right? You know, I think what this tells us is we should have flare guns in our trunks in case we ever end up in a town.
I think that's good advice for everyone.
Yeah, but it is that interesting thing. Like, if you can, you know, if you have enough of these things, you can walk the road, launching them to see if it.
Sure.
If it's like across, like, is it making a loop visible from the town, or is it like a straight line out and a straight line in, and all of a sudden, you know, you're transported to the other side of the town?
Okay.
That actually is a brilliant thing, Ben, because I'm thinking of it as a loop, but like if you think about the way asteroids works, if it's a box with periodic boundary conditions, there's a discontinuity where you're driving on the road and you go from one side of the box to the other.
Yeah, exactly.
And your signals would show that up. And I do think, Dan, this is the key to finding, like, there has to be, let's face it, it's probably not teleportation because it's not magic. So it's some sort of topology. Right. Let's believe it's physics and geometry.
That's a great idea.
There is going to be a discontinuity of some sort in the structure. And if you have enough flares and you walk around, that blip will show up. Mm-hmm. And when you find that blip or glitch, that's when you can start looking for your way out.
Yeah. I mean, for all we know, you're on a tiny little sphere with that somehow still has the normal amount of gravity. And, you know, the woods are just obscuring the fact that the horizon falls away way too fast.
That's interesting. Well, so, I mean, the world, the shape of the world is kind of cool. And I think we'd be able to figure our way out because we'd have to get out pretty quickly. Because as we've seen in the show, you know, nightfall, I'm sure we wouldn't figure it out by the time we got there until night fell. Mm-hmm. Because once, you know, once the moon comes up and it gets dark, monsters come out of the trees, out of the forest, and it's pretty terrifying. They found this really interesting way to keep the monsters at bay with these stones with inscriptions on them. This feels like some kind of magic, but I don't think that it is. And the goal is to keep these creatures, which look normal on the outside. They look like other human beings. I mean, they're a little weird. They smile a lot, and they're super creepy.
Yeah, well,
but other than that, you can't tell them from another human being.
Well, there's one that's especially creepy. It looks like Joker without the makeup, but
yes, yeah.
But beyond that, yeah, they look pretty normal. But one thing we see is that the talismans seem to be similar to the drawings they themselves make. These monsters. So, you know, I'm gonna steal Dr. Denon's bit here. You know, it kind of seems almost biblical to me, where you know, something like the angel of death, you know, marking your doors. And if you mark your door with the talisman, you're telling these creatures you're like one of them or something along those lines.
Oh, like if you're putting on zombie juice to make the zombies think you're one of them.
Yeah.
Oh, so it's a camouflage device more than magic.
I don't know about camouflage. I think it's just saying here lie other monsters, although they're still asking to come in. So maybe not. I don't know.
Well, I do like the basic principle, Ben. It does rely on the monsters being a bit dumb, but that's okay. Many monsters are. That's why the zombies try and eat more brains. We know that, right? To make themselves more intelligent. Mm-hmm. I went a hardcore physics route here, gentlemen, and which is, you know, we know the electricity is weird. Mm-hmm. And I think these are electromagnetic conduits, and they create sort of a circuit around the house. And that's why you need a continuous surface. If I open a window or open a door, I break the circuit. And it's sort of like those pet fences you have now, right, that are wireless.
Right,
like, you know, you just need a few, you know, whatever, antenna. No one didn't think of it and relies on antenna.
Right, right.
Right, and your dog can't get out. And that may connect to these drawings, Ben, right? They may be, you know, afraid of these things because they know they create this sort of pain, like these collars and radio fences.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's interesting. I mean, is that how they're kept inside during the day, right? Because like we see these catacombs that they're allegedly in during the day.
Right. We find, you know, the main character whose name escapes me right now, his real name, I believe, is Harold. Boyd is his name. So he goes into the forest and finds a stack, you know, of these stones, which makes me feel like the monsters may have gone and collected them, either for their own use or to stop, allowing them to enter into these houses to stop that circuit. Like there's some kind of, you know, point to collecting them all.
Or perhaps that's where the creator of this place would hide at night to protect himself from protect themselves from their own creation.
Right. Oh. Yeah, like a safety fortress.
Yeah. Well, because we see, you know, it's kind of interesting because in one of the first episodes, we do see one of these creatures coming into a house. They ask to come in, very vampire-esque, you know, it's a little Twilight element to this. So you have, they ask to come in, and this little girl seeing her grandmother, you know, floating on the second story, that didn't raise alarm bells. But nonetheless, the door opens up, and then the monster comes in. And we see that, you know, in a later episode as well. And, you know, is it... You know, this kind of answers that question, Denon, because we see them ask, and then when they're allowed, it's not necessarily verbally consenting to them coming in. The door just opens, and then they come in and wreak havoc. And I think you might be right. There's some breaking of the seal, you know, that circuit being broken. Whatever's keeping them at bay has now been removed, and that allows them to come in, which means that everyone who's using one of these stones is in a much more precarious situation than even they believe.
Yeah, I think that's right. And it also goes to another point. This is clearly our episode for lessons, Dan. Ben already shared that you need to have flares. The example you gave shows why it's so important to raise your children on fantasy novels, science fiction, and as much as I hate them, horror films, because it is important survival training. Any child that had been raised appropriately would not have opened the window for a floating grandma on the second floor, right?
That's
this clearly shows bad parenting from the beginning.
Well, it's basic.
Yeah. Well, I mean, to be fair, I don't think she was floating. I think she was like standing on the covered porch roof. But
still, safety warnings all over the place.
Why is your grandma on top of the covered porch?
Yeah, why is she on the second floor?
And fair enough. She may not be. Says you don't look like my grandma, or you don't sound like my grandma. Like, what is wrong with this? And the mom like doesn't run faster. Like, come on.
There's a lot of questions that need to be answered.
And why
here.
Wasn't the window nailed shut? Like. They say, nail your windows shut. Like, did the kid have a crowbar and we didn't see her undo all the nails really quick? Like, what's going on here?
What's going on? Well, yeah, I mean, the first clue here, no matter, you know I don't like kids. I think they're all dumb and useless and are contributing to the overpopulation of the earth. Nonetheless, we still have to, if we are going to have kids, let's teach them properly. And a grandmother on the second floor, whether floating or simply standing, that's weird, unusual. That should be reported immediately.
Dan, so what can help is if you use FGGG merch because then you got a training mechanism for your kids. You know, like you start with the drinking cups, they learn some cool phrases, you know, and then they build up through the other merchandise. And it's really life lessons. It's not just a mug. It's a training vehicle and life lessons for surviving the world, because that's what this show is about. You know, going back, if they've missed it, they should watch the classic episode, Dan, where you learn how to use toilet water appropriately.
Yeah, right. That was a lesson. I was so glad to learn that. And I could have accidentally, you know, taken a sip of toilet water out of an FGGGbt mug. And that would have been horrific for me, for sure.
Well, I mean, speaking of water, you know, I don't think the monsters carry FGGGbt water bottles either. But what's important about them is, one, I don't think they're nearly stylish to have their own. But, you know, they also can't be harmed by bullets. But, you know, maybe if you hit a monster over the head with this delightful stainless steel water bottle, maybe that would, in fact, do some damage.
Oh, I think it would. I think it would, Ben.
I think so. I mean, you know, whether they're for drinking and for peaceful means or for weapon, you can weaponize them like all things. But one thing you shouldn't weaponize is a nice shirt. You know, like this one, it says biology is nature's technology. This can be an armor, but you never want to use it to strangle a monster. I think that that's probably, I think the water mug is probably a much better option. But let's say you don't have any of that stuff, right? Let's say you want to tase or electrocute some of these monsters. Sure. How are you going to do that in this strange, wacky world where electricity doesn't seem to flow through wires? Outlets are super crazily formed. It's like everyone's in Europe over there. They got like vertical and horizontal plugs. It's bananas. What's going on with electricity, with magnetism, with radio waves? It's a weird world. You know, the topography is not the only problem here, Denon.
No, I agree. The only thing I can think of here, Dan, and this actually is very relevant because it happened to me last night. I tend to use a wireless charger for my phone. And 9 times out of 10, it charges fine. I suspect my cats like knock it around. And so there's some mornings I wake up and it's not charged, you know, and this was one of those. But
they aren't doing that by accident either, Denon. That's on purpose.
No, I know it's on purpose. Yeah. And so, you know, the reason I bring this up is I feel like this is a world of wireless generation, right? Everything is induction based, right? We are very, very used to everything being wire based, where you plug things in and they're connected. But I was really trying to think about, like, could you actually have done a wire-free infrastructure where everything is induction-based? So instead of plugging things in, the electricity in every object you build is generated through induction. And that's why I went kind of with the stone things working the way they did, through some sort of induction mechanism. Yeah. And if everything's wireless-based, I do have a feeling all of those generators and extra wireless signals could be messing with your radios then at ground level, right? It's a different kind of problem you have in that space. So I'm not as afraid of antennas as Ben is. I am a bit mystified by them. Electricity and magnetism is the subject in grad school I chose to ignore. And I've never taught it since I have been a professor. Wow. But that's where I'm going, Dan. I think it's a basic wireless technology and system. And they put fake wires in just to fool the people because they want them to be confused.
Yeah, well, E&M was definitely the electrical engineering part that I minimized as much as possible. I like what you're saying here. You know, it kind of reminds me of, you know, like Tesla's dream of free wireless electricity and all that, and how it's a great idea in theory, but in reality, you like ionize the atmosphere and make it impossible to have any wireless communication whatsoever. And also horses get shocked from their horseshoes. So lots of problems with it.
Very specific.
But so, you know, it's this interesting theory. You know, the other thing I was thinking is, you know, these wires are potentially also wave, instead of it being like a traditional copper conductor, maybe there's some waveguide stuff going on. A waveguide is a way to control the flow of electromagnetic energy through kind of basically a tube rather than just a wire. Wires actually kind of act like waveguides, but you can do fancier things with like actual like pipes, copper pipes. And so maybe these wires, instead of being normal wires, they're, you know, maybe there's some like secret metallic thread in them that's letting them act as waveguides.
And, you know, and just to take that abstract engineering waveguide description to a different level, we've all played with the fun little toys, you know, like at amusement parks where you turn on a light and the fiber optics make the light come out the end instead of through things. That's the waveguide Ben's talking about. And I'm all on board on that, right? That we combine my idea of everything sort of induction-based with the waveguide idea to transmit things so they're not all over the air and making your horses shock themselves with their horseshoes. Though I didn't see any horses. There are probably horses somewhere and I missed them. I just saw like goats and pigs.
There's goats and cows, you know, close enough.
Yeah.
Close enough. We'll put shoes on them too.
But you know, some sort of basic technology of these levels, combining these things, Dan, is really, I think, the physics and engineering of where we are in getting their electricity here.
Yeah. Well, I like that you brought up the fiber optics, because that's actually, in some ways, even a better idea, because you can directly transfer power with the fiber optic using like photodiodes and things like that. Now, these two engineers in the show, surely
I was just going to say,
noticed right, such a thing. But you know, maybe they didn't fully deconstruct the lamps. I don't know.
Right. I was going to say, there are two engineers that were, I mean, one was a roller coaster engineer, which is more like the fun type. But the other guy was, you know, he was a pretty serious electrical engineer.
Yeah. Well, he was a computer scientist.
Sorry.
You know, I will say a roller coaster engineer is actually one of the most serious engineers of them all.
Okay. I apologize.
Because it's public safety. It's public safety engineering. It's actually, you know, when you think about what I do or what I did, like with, you know, rockets, you know, those only launch, you know, once every couple of days, right, at best. You know, but a roller coaster runs hundreds of times a day. Hundreds of times a day. And so if there's anything that can possibly go wrong on a roller coaster, it will go wrong eventually because of how much it's used. So it's actually a much scarier type of engineering. And also you have people who are not expecting to be on a dangerous situation.
Fair enough. But you don't have a lot of people working at Disneyland who are doing cutting it. I mean, It's a Small World hasn't been updated in about 60 years. So, you know, induction-based electrical transfer is probably not, you know. Although that song really gets stuck in your head.
Maybe not on Small World, but like the newest Star Wars rides use some very fancy tech you know, cars that drive around without tracks and things like that. It's some fancy stuff.
Well, I'd like to take this moment to apologize for all the roller coaster engineers that I've offended. Luckily, Ben has educated me, and I will never make that mistake again. Because you don't want to make a mistake like that. You know, one mistake in this world, and that's the end of you. You know, we talked about trees, and there's one moment where there seems to be some kind of interconnected system network of trees that have a big hole in them. You walk in one tree and you end up somewhere else. It seems to be random. It's very similar to the warp pipes in Super Mario Brothers, except those you typically knew what world you were going to. But we see one particular moment where Boyd and this girl named Sarah walk into a tree. They walk into the same tree seconds apart and end up in two entirely different places. So, you know, one little mistake, one miscalculation, and you're doomed. You're stuck in a well.
Well, I was wondering about that, having watched it, Dan. And you know, the first explanation when the old creepy guy with the lunchbox, whose name I can't remember, throws a rock in.
Victor,
It's Victor.
Victor, thank you.
Yeah.
And explains that, you know, the rock can go anywhere and varies. I was trying to listen to that carefully. I couldn't quite tell if the same rock would end up in different places. And the reason I think that's important is I wonder if this is a mass-triggered thing, right? That, like, if when you go into it, right, the amount of mass you have, because, and bear with me, by general relativity, we know warping space and time and gravity is actually what mass does, and the two are connected. And if this whole world is about space being warped and twisted and bent into interesting shapes, you could imagine that what happens is you go into this, it is an incredibly sensitive mass detector. That's theory A. Theory B is the trees are moving in the wind, and when you jump in, you know, the tree's pointed somewhere else because the wind is blown. That's basically the two things I've got there, Dan.
Those are opposite ends of the specificity spectrum.
Oh, they are.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's also the third option in that it's, you know, this is an engineered world. And, you know, there's just a, you know, a random number generator that decides where you end up when you go in.
Option C. Option D is the engineer sitting there at a switchboard pushing a button, sending you somewhere on purpose.
Right. I mean, if this is like some sort of horror Truman show, you know, they might just be sending you wherever is most dramatically interesting.
And option E is they're all hamsters and squirrels that are really running the electronics for all of this. Which is my personal favorite. This is a weird world. We can at least admit this is a very strange system. There seem to be logical ways to tie it all together, but nonetheless, even with the best, I mean, Denon, you got this huge spectrum of weird possibilities. That's where we are with this.
It is, though. I do like, one thing I like about, when you mentioned consistency, Dan, mm-hmm. one thing I like about the tree teleporters, which at first I was worried I wouldn't like at all, is the connection between that and the trees that block you down in the road, right? Mm-hmm. And right. so early on, we talked about mapping out the road and the boundary conditions and all of that. One thing that would be really interesting is if this was a world with discrete boundaries, right? We've been talking about and thinking about worlds having a continuous boundary, a sphere, mm-hmm. a donut, and so on. Mm-hmm. But you could imagine an odd shape where the boundaries are not continuous. We think of everything being continuous in space, mm-hmm. that every tree is a boundary point, or at least relevant trees. Maybe it's not all trees. Maybe mm-hmm. it's a subset of trees, right? And so the trees falling on the road represent that discrete boundary where you went in, and the trees that are teleporting are sort of internal boundary points in a weird way. Like they're boundaries, and that's why you can move from one point to another, because these are those discontinuities I mentioned. So it just makes for a very, very weird structure. And the boundaries maybe flop around in space. So when you go into the tree, they're not always connected in the same way.
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, talking about this a little more makes me just wonder, like, does no one have a compass in this world? Like, what would happen? I mean, I'm curious. Like, is a compass just spinning randomly? Is it always?
You only have what you bring in. That's the other thing we didn't really mention, is that when you're trapped, you have what's in the car. Right. I mean, I think that the first family comes in with, you know, Winnebago. I'm sure that there might be a compass built into this. It looks like a pretty old Winnebago. Yeah. But then you have a bus coming in. You know, some people have phones, but I don't think they're not exactly working, you know, the right way. There's electromagnetism's all, you know, getting screwed up.
Yeah. I mean, that's what's interesting about, because there are. Well, one, I would expect somebody to have a compass, but maybe because this is a chosen environment, it just chooses cars that don't have compasses in them.
Yeah. I think that's exactly what it is. They get to decide. They definitely get to decide. Well, the one thing I want to quickly mention before we close up here is, you know, you mentioned Victor Denon, and one of the cool things that he does is he maps out where the trees are and mm-hmm. knows when they move. You know, inches, feet, the distance, you know, he's using crayons and, you know, footsteps. So accuracy is not, I don't think it's where we would like it to be. But it's still interesting that he's able to notice these changes and that they're happening. Things mm-hmm. are moving.
Right.
And this tells you a lot about, you know, the world itself.
Well, that makes me really wonder about my fluctuating boundary theory, right? Mm-hmm. Particularly since it's the trees that are moving, mm-hmm. right? So, you know, sort of think of it's hard to think about what it might be, but maybe think of like a spiky ball, right? Like a ball mm-hmm. with spikes on it. And the main boundary issues are the spikes. Like those are the key things that are going to be the boundary of your world. But, mm-hmm. but there's a fluidness to this where the spikes kind of can shift around and move, sometimes fall over in front of a road, making a weird boundary. Right.
Yeah.
That's why he's mapping the trees, and that's why the teleport trees connect differently at different times. And so there could be a little bit of a, and this could be a design element, Ben, or it could just be a natural part of the world.
I mean, the thing is, though, he has rope. Like he could measure it and mark the rope. you know.
Yeah, there goes the engineer getting more precise, solving that, building us tools. I love it.
It's a little more precise.
Yeah, like they have laundry lines for drying their laundry. They could use some of that clothesline to get some really precise measure, or heck, tie the tree to the house and see what happens. Does the line break?
I do love that you've managed to use rope and just a long piece of whatever as kind of like a Swiss Army knife to solve all of your engineering mathematical problems. That's really cool. I mean, you can kind of do so much with a piece of rope here.
Yeah, you know, if you think the trees are moving, put objects between things and the trees to see if they are in fact moving. Don't try to measure it with footsteps.
I will just say, I'm mm-hmm. glad Ben brought up rope, and Dan, that connects to the earlier part of the show, because this is obviously a topological loop and we're starting over. Because you mentioned D&D, and we all know the only relevant thing you ever use in your backpack is your rope, Because of course everybody has dark vision, so why would you ever use a torch?
you gotta have rope.
You know, and it's you just, rope is for everything.
You don't want to omit rope in your fantasy backpack, just like you don't want to admit incredible things on this show. So we've reached our errors, additions, and omissions section, things we wanted to talk about, but we didn't quite get to. Denon, I'm sure that there's something about From that we didn't quite mention you wanted to talk about.
Well, I just love the fact that they've developed this system of, okay, we're going to watch these people drive around in circles for a while. It's kind of like the entertainment because there's no movies or TV. And then at some point, we're going to put spikes in the road and blow their tires out because, like, we get tired. I don't know. Like how many laps do you give the average person before you blow out their tires? Like, what's the rule here?
And why are they blowing out the tires? You'd think they just, like, set up a barrier or something.
It's a little extreme. I'm with
you.
A
little extreme. And dangerous.
Yeah.
So that was one of my main ones. And again, I just want to thank you, Dan, for bringing up Ravenloft. It's fun memories of a childhood. I promised, you know, sharing the vampire story. Basically, the vampire turned to gas, was escaping out the castle. And one of the characters said, I leap after it and catch it in this vial I have. I set an insane, this was back, remember, before like current D&D. So like it was, you know, advanced D&D with percentages. I set an insane roll, let them roll. They successfully captured the vampire. I did point out that their character could not fly and had no skills and was in midair over the bottom of the castle. The character fell. They had to roll again for the vial not to break. The vial did not break, but the character was mush.
But that's a great ending. I mean,
it was a
because
great
the vampire's
ending,
captured. That's a
soft
that's a
landing
great
for the
D&D
vial.
Ending.
Yep.
Yeah, that's true. And that's all that they needed to do because the Strahd von Zarkovic is much more evil and it's more important you capture him than they survive. That is the true essence of Ravenloft, then, and you captured it. What about you, Ben? Anything we missed you wanted to talk about?
Well, you know, speaking of danger and hazards, you know, when they're setting up all these like lamp cords and car wire harnesses to power their antenna. I'm just thinking I was thinking they're never going to send a signal. They're just going to burn the house down.
They almost did.
I'm just watching this and I'm like, this is dumber than a dried out Christmas tree with frayed Christmas lights.
Yep. That's true. We saw what happened in Christmas Vacation. So, bad things do happen. You know, one of the things that I really enjoyed about this, Victor kind of grew on me. He's a really cool character. And I think of the trauma as, you know, being there at 10 years old and having to live through all these deaths and having to hide for, you know, 40 plus years and then having drawings and he's still, you know, mapping out the world with crayons. I mean, that's pretty impressive, you know. So I got to give him credit for that. He's you know, that's a really cool system for sure. But of course, you know, if we've missed anything else, let us know. You know, you can find us on social media. The show is at FGGBTpod on Twitter, at FGGBT on Facebook, website, FGGBT.com. And if you want to send us a question, questions at FGGBT.com. But you can get in touch with us individually. Denon, where can people find you?
Well, they can reach me at almost every major social media. You just flip my name. That's at Denon Michael. But if you're going for Facebook, you got to stick in the prof, at Prof Denon Michael.
Ben, where can people find you?
You can find me on all the major social media networks at B Siepser.
How do you spell that?
Spell that B-S-I-E-P-S-E-R.
And I can be found on Twitter at Daniel J. Glenn, on Instagram at The Daniel J. Glenn, and on Facebook at Analytical Mastermind. And check out my website, danieljglenn.com, if you want to find out more.
And if you're listening on your favorite podcast platform, make sure to rate, review, and subscribe.
And if you enjoyed this video, hit the like button, subscribe, and ring that bell so you never miss an episode. And leave us a comment telling us, what gadget would you want to bring in to this world to try to figure your way out?
Well, we would definitely need to. We got to get out of the. We figured some things out, but who doesn't love more gadgets, right? And I think that that's important because you have to remember, we've given you lots of information that could be misused by those hell-bent on world domination. So you want to take this information and do good with it. Remember, you always want to be a superhero, never a supervillain. So until next time, thank you for listening.